ಹೇಳಿ.
ಸ್ಟಾರ್ಟ್ ಮಾಡಲ್ಲ ಮೇಡಮ್?
ಮಾಡೋಣ ಮಾಡೋಣ.
Hello, good evening everyone. On behalf of Mayer Organics, I Madhusudan extends a warm welcome to you all for today's Knowledge Cafe webinar. Topic on role of micronutrients in female infertility. So before we begin, we hope that you all are safe, healthy and providing your service with utmost safety precautions. We will always be grateful towards your devotion to the humanity. We are very happy to make come true the dreams of many expectant couples and provide nourishing hands through our pregnancy care range. We believe in providing a strong foundation right from preconceptual stage till pregnancy through ultra calcium, ova care for her, oligo care 4 plus for him, ultra Q and many more. So today we have the most brilliant and super talented speaker, Dr. Rekha Rajendra Kumar, who will be presenting on role of micronutrients in female infertility. So to give you a brief about our today's speaker, Madam has done MBBS, MD, DNB, followed by a fellowship in reproductive medicine. So she has done diploma in human resource development. Madam has done diploma in hospital administration. Doctor has done diploma in health and hospital management. When it comes to awards and achievement, Madam is All India topper in ICOG reproductive medicine exam. Madam scored first rank in MD University exam. Doctor scored 7th rank in MBBS in Bangalore University exam. Doctor got 6 awards and 3 felicitations, including 2 state awards, Kittur Rani Chennamma State Award. And Madam is currently medical director for Miracle IBS Hospital and Chandan Hospital. When it comes to paper and publications, Madam has presented 1 case report and 14 original articles, more than 50 radio and TV talks. So let's get ready for our scientific program with Dr. Rekha Rajendra Kumar. Over to you, Doctor.
Namaste.
Thank you.
Yeah. Can you move the slide? Shall I do that?
Yes, Madam. Yes. Yes,
all right. Good evening all on a Saturday evening. Thank you all the attendees, participants for being here to listen to me. I will talk on role of micronutrients in female infertility. Why do we need these micronutrients? I'm talking one in relation to female infertility only, but why do we need the micronutrients in the women who could not conceive all these days? Because the food that we eat are not always packed with nutrients, especially the micronutrients, because these micronutrients are the bridging gaps. They are very essential for the effective working of our body system, be it be brain, heart or our fertility organs. Thanks to the change in the methods of farming, we know that farming has seen lot of changes. There is sea change in farming. Not only the farming, the greenery is what we eat, even the milk or the meat what people consume has found lot of changes. In the sense, to get a better yield, the farmers are using lot of manures, lot of chemicals, and so many things are added to the soil to make the soil fertile. In the mealy, what happens that probably we are losing all the natural minerals that are in the soil. And also we have heard that cows are getting lot of chemicals into their body because the farmer wants a better yield of milk. We want all Denmark cows with big fleshy cows. So in the mealy, we are losing the natural nutrients and the minerals which is already in the soil. So ultimately we don't get proper nutrition, and I think that is the reason why we need these micronutrients, and those have become the need of the hour. As we get older, our ability to absorb nutrients from food also decreases, as all of us know. Why? Because our gut becomes atrophied over the ages. Our body cannot absorb as much as it wants. Probably the gut villi also become atrophied. The previous kind of multiple folds in the villi are not there. Ultimately, the capacity of the intestinal villi comes down, and because of that, the absorption also comes comes down. Our energy needs are also not the same, as all of us know, and we tend to eat less also. Other than so many other factors where our food intake varies from day to day. In one particular day also, our consumption of food varies. Depends upon the time when we eat, our appetite, sometimes we don't want to eat, our mood swings, we are busy with our work schedule. So many factors which influence, and ultimately we sometimes skip our meal or eat less. Some people want to reduce weight. So with all these factors being considered, the nutrients what we take becomes less and the absorption becomes further less. The dietary supplements would seem to be the obvious way to plug the gap. One end of the spectrum is what we want to eat. The other end of the spectrum is what we should eat and what our body is fully done. In the sense, it's full of supplements, totally nourished body. In between these two poles, the bridging gap would be the dietary supplements, because it add certain things, some divine things to our body and makes our body in a better shape and better state. If you are unable to make the dietary changes, sometimes it happens, or if you have a genuine deficiency in a particular nutrient. Many of us, when we do the blood test nowadays, are very much deficient in vitamin D and vitamin B12, as all of you know. So the supplementation of these things is very necessary and becomes more helpful. The vitamin D supplementation is almost done for all our female infertile patients nowadays, because there are a lot of papers, lot of studies which say that vitamin D is very helpful and it boosts the male and female infertility both. Now, coming to the point of what are the things that happen in female infertility? What are the causes? As all of us know, there are a lot of causes. We are not going to go into the detail of this. This is just an overview of the causes of female infertility. I'm going to talk about the micronutrients in female infertility. This picture just shows where all the problems can be, and thus leading to female infertility. Now, this is a very busy slide, maybe a bit confusing and a bit irritating for you all, I understand. But just want to tell, the gist of this is the PCOS, the polycystic ovarian syndrome, has multifactorial etiology. The pathogenesis can be because of so many things. It may be the environmental factor, the stress factor, increased ROS, elevated hyperhomocysteine levels, hyperinsulinemia, so many things. I will talk about this in my future slides. This is just overview of where all problems can be in PCOS women. The polycystic ovarian syndrome, what are the key factors? What is the key pathology that happens here? It is an endocrine system disorder in women of the reproductive age, which results in the hormonal imbalance ultimately. The three key things that happen, or the patient presentation, would be hyperandrogenism, menstrual irregularity, and when we do a transvaginal scan, we see the big bulky or the typical polycystic ovaries. These are all the different features. In front of hyperandrogenism, I have written what are all the features of hyperandrogenism. So similarly, in menstrual regularity, patients may come with oligomenorrhea, hasn't had a period for 3 months, 6 months, or maybe only one period in the whole year. Some people may be totally amenorrheic and they will bleed only when you give progesterone. That is only progesterone withdrawal bleeding and no spontaneous menstruation. LH is definitely raised in these people. Multiple small, tiny, chota follicles in the ovary, both sides, bulky ovaries. The stroma is increased, as we call as a necklace pattern of the ovary. So these are all the different features we see on the sonography. Now, what do we do about the treatment? There are different kinds of treatment which are tailored according to each one's needs. One man's meat is another man's poison, right? So we have to tailor it according to that woman's needs, what she needs. Someone may need only the menstrual cycle regulation, like an adolescent girl or the one who has finished her family, where the other one may need only the ovulation, because we are trying for infertility treatment. We want to get her pregnant. She is not bothered of getting her menstrual cycle regular, or she is not bothered about her hyperandrogenism. So in her case, we want ovulation to happen, we want her to conceive, whereas adolescent girl, we want her menstrual cycle to be regular. So it depends upon what the patient needs. But this chart shows that all different treatments, in summary, what we give in a case of PCOS. Now, the treatment objectives by the gynecologist would be restoration of the regular menstruation, of course, as I told previously, like in an adolescent girl or the woman who has completed family, no more interested in getting pregnancy. Lowering insulin levels is very much necessary because there's a hyperinsulinemic state in these women. Restoration of fertility for some people, and treatment of the hirsutism is very much necessary, maybe from the cosmetic view or even otherwise, because the hyperandrogenism itself is a thing that happens in infertility, which needs correction. The role of multiple micronutrients in improving fertility. This says not only PCOS, regarding all fertility cases where they want to get pregnant. Adequate levels, I have put all many studies here because many studies have strengthened our view that micronutrients are very much necessary, have to be supplemented. Even if it is a general practitioner who is seeing a patient, if they correct the vitamin D deficiency, vitamin B12 deficiency, or sometimes the iron deficiency, the patient may get spontaneously pregnant. Many of the unexplained infertility cases where whatever test you do, the HSG, you do hysterosalpingography, the tubes are fine, you do hysteroscopy, uterine cavity is normal, the male factor is normal, everything is normal. So ultimately we label as unexplained infertility because you can't explain what the problem is. Ultimately it may be a cause, it may be the problem, the root cause may be the deficiency of nutrients. So any doctor who sees such patients who come seeking for fertility, if their nutrition is corrected with so many micronutrients, which I am going to speak in future slides. So if they are corrected, these women, some of them will definitely get pregnant spontaneously. So adequate levels of nutrients are important for the oocyte quality itself. The quality when we do the ovum pickup or even in IUA or whatever investigation or treatment you do in these women, the quality of oocyte will be good. You get proper M2 oocytes. The maturation of the oocyte has happened. The fertilization, once we do with IVF, ICSI or even IUA, the fertilization of these follicles would be better. The cells multiply evenly inside the morula. The implantation is good because the embryo is very good quality embryo. The endometrium also has improved because you have supplemented her with micronutrients like vitamin D. So the crosstalk between the endometrium and the embryo has become very good. One become very friendly and conducive with the other. So the implantation does not go as a failure and she conceives on her own. So whereas the antioxidants are vital to reduce the oxidative stress, what we call as the ROS, reactive oxidative species, these become more when she is deficient in nutrients. So the oxidative stress is equal to ROS. That gets reduced when you supplement her with micronutrients. Regular use of multivitamin supplements may decrease the risk of ovulatory infertility itself. Not only the endometrium, not only the tubal factor, not only the sperm factor, even the ovulatory factor itself, when you are stimulating with her injections or when you are going to taking a natural cycle for monitoring, her follicles grow very nicely. She gets a good follicles, multiple follicles develop, and naturally the further process is going to be very nice and friendly. Women susceptible to micronutrients deficiencies should receive the micronutrient supplement to optimize their reproductive health. So these are all the books from where these sentences have been quoted, which I have mentioned, and I'm not going to mention about the journals in each slide. I'm just going to highlight the factors what they have quoted. Some studies have shown that higher intake of iron, folic acid, vitamin D, and vitamin E is another divine vitamin. So these all play a beneficial role in female infertility, beneficial role. Promoting healthy dietary patterns and higher folate intake among individuals experiencing infertility may improve their chances of achieving a pregnancy. All of us, all the practitioners we do put the women when they come seeking for fertility with simple course of 3 months of folic acid once a day, about 5 milligrams of folic acid. Though it is little more, we don't get a 4 milligram tablet, so we put them on 5 milligram once a day of the tablet, and that is very beneficial. And many of them do come back to us with urine test positive, or even once they are positive, once the pregnancy is confirmed, we do put them on folic acid so that their pregnancy continues in a very uncomplicated fashion. So folate supplementation is very necessary for the woman to get pregnant, and also later on for the proper development of the embryo. We know that NTD, neural tube defects, are much lesser when the folate is supplemented. So folate is a very friendly vitamin we need pre-pregnancy and once the woman has conceived. Adequate intake of antioxidants support the female reproductive functions, along with the intake of dietary supplements containing folic acid, beta carotene, vitamin C, E, etc., are definitely efficient in shortening the time to conception. This is what I was telling. Some facts may get overlapped because they are the excerpts from different journals. So some facts may be overlapping here. Now, another thing is myo-inositol. It's a buzzword now. All of us are hearing about myo-inositol. This is the drug. It's a kind of nutrient only. It's not a proper pharmaceutical formula, but it is a nutrient supplementation which has to be given in case of PCOS women, polycystic ovarian syndrome women. Why do we need myo-inositol? Because inositols are the ones which improve the insulin resistance. They decrease the hyperinsulinemic state of the body. They make the hyperglycemic state much lesser. They bring the hyperglycemic state under control because they increase the intracellular glucose utilization and uptake of glucose. So ultimately, they make the body milieu very conducive for pregnancy, because hyperinsulinemic state and hyperglycemic state are very, very hostile for one to conceive. So ultimately what happens, the serum androgen concentration also comes down and follicle maturation happens. Once the follicle is matured, there is going to be the egg release from the follicle, and that is what we call as ovulation. Now, how does the myo-inositol act? Why it helps in oogenesis, or how it helps in oogenesis? It causes the intracellular calcium release, and thus it helps in the oocyte maturation. Because of inositols, myo-inositol and D-chiro inositols and estradiol, there is an increase in the human follicular fluid once we supplement. So that causes the follicle maturity, and it provides a marker of the good quality oocytes. The follicular maturity and good quality oocytes are the ones which are one step very nearer to the pregnancy happening. Nuclear and cytoplasmic oocyte development, it should be hand in hand. There should be no discrepancy between the nuclear and cytoplasmic maturity. So what does this do? All the things what I explained, it helps not only in the reduction of the glucose in the blood, not only improving the insulin sensitivity, thus it also reduces the hyperandrogenic state, and thus it reduces the acne, hirsutism, all that thing. And ultimately the menstrual cycle, even if she does not want to conceive, say the adolescent girl, in her case, the menstrual cycle also start becoming almost near normal. If she is menstruating once a year, or if she has only withdrawal bleed after giving progesterone, she start menstruating on her own. She starts getting her spontaneous cycles. This is because of myo-inositol. It improves the follicular maturity and oocyte quality, as I have explained already. So it has got multi-pronged approach. So ultimately it helps for menstrual regularity, ovulatory function, and SSH hormone binding globulin also becomes better, pregnancy outcome is better, etc. Now, what are the clinical evidences for this myo-inositol therapy? Myo-inositol in poor responders results in an increased number of M2 oocytes. This is what I was telling. M2 oocytes recovered, that is the mature oocytes, and of the gonadotropin ovarian sensitivity index. In the sense, the yield of the follicles and thus the M2 oocytes for the dose of gonadotropin what we give becomes much better. Otherwise, there will be a lot of discrepancy. You keep increasing the dose of gonadotropin, but the follicles don't grow. Even if the follicles do grow, when we do the pickup, the M2 oocytes are not collected to the extent of what gonadotrophin dose we have given. So that discrepancy is narrowed, suggesting a myo-inositol role in improving the ovarian response to gonadotrophin. The gonadotrophins become much obedient and much better. They listen to the ovarian response become much better, and they listen to the gonadotrophin dose given. They respond to the dose of gonadotrophin given. Myo-inositol supplement also improves ultimately the clinical pregnancy rate in infertile women undergoing ovulation induction because of all these things when you do either IVF or ICSI. By rescuing the ovarian response to endogenous gonadotrophins, myo-inositol also reduces androgenemia, again told already, and it re-establishes the menstrual cyclicity. May not be totally on the dot at the end of 30 days, but the response of the menstruation, in the sense getting spontaneous menstruation, becomes much better. The cyclicity becomes much better. Indirectly, it reflects that ovulation also becomes better because the hormonal milieu has become much friendlier, thus increasing the chance of spontaneous pregnancy. A positive correlation was found between the myo-inositol concentration in the follicular fluid that was studied. The concentration of follicular fluid when we do the ovum pickup, the concentration of myo-inositol in the follicular fluid to the oocyte quality. Myo-inositol is also important in the improvement of the endocrine metabolic profile in PCOS. These are some repetitions because they are from different journals. The inositols, myo-inositol and dechiro-inositol can reduce the insulin resistance, improve the ovarian function and reduce the androgen levels in women with PCOS, says Indian Journal of Endocrinological Metabolism. Myo-inositol deficiency in women with PCOS is associated with the poor quality oocytes and altered folliculogenesis. Yes, of course, we have spoken all this while. Now coming to the vitamin D, I have spoken about myo-inositol. Now I'm talking a little bit about vitamin D, because these are all the different kinds of micronutrients. This improves, supplementation of vitamin D improves the insulin sensitivity in PCOS patients. Otherwise, there is a hyperinsulinemic state in these women that comes under control with supplementation of vitamin D. It acts as an immunomodulator. This is very, very important. It acts as an immunomodulator in treatment of recurrent miscarriage or even patients of RIF, that is recurrent implantation failure. What happens in these women, the crosstalk between the embryo and the endometrium is not so friendly, not so conducive. The endometrium does not accept the embryo. The pleomorphism on the trophoblastic surface of the embryo is not so friendly with the endometrium. Because of this, though endometrial thickness has been maintained, has been prepared, the endometrium circulation, the blood circulation with the Doppler has been very good. In spite of that, the embryo is not embraced by the endometrium. The endometrium rejects the embryo. Ultimately, that results in recurrent implantation failure, or it may even lead to the miscarriages once the urine test has been positive or the beta HCG was confirmed as positive, she lands up in miscarriage. Maybe because of vitamin deficiency, D deficiency, who knows. Prevention of gestational diabetes and preeclampsia also may be because of vitamin D. It has a mammoth role in prevention of gestational diabetes and preeclampsia according to many studies. It improves the pregnancy rates in infertile women undergoing IVF and ICSI, and also higher success ultimately in IVF cases. Again, a busy slide but confusing slide, but try to put everything in one slide. Don't worry, it just says that, just take the message that the vitamin D metabolism, and it has got salient action, and it's in the red box. We have shown that it helps for both ovary, testes, placenta, gametogenesis. So it's good for all. It's a Sanjeevani or a divine medicine which has got multi-pronged benefits. This is all what one is supposed to know in this slide. It has little detail and shows how it happens. It works on new neurons, pancreatic cells, on all the target organs. Vitamin D deficiency in the reproductive area years is contributory to ovulatory infertility. Deficiency causes impaired ovulation, and the cause of ovulatory infertility may be because of vitamin D deficiency. Low levels of 25-hydroxy vitamin D were significantly associated with not only infertility, even other autoimmune problems like autoimmune thyroiditis in women with PCOS. Low serum 25-hydroxy vitamin D concentrations result from the presence of obesity and insulin resistance. Hypovitaminosis D, that is deficiency of vitamin D, should be kept in mind while managing the obese women with PCOS. To a large extent, PCOS women are obese. All are not lean PCOS women. Many are obese. Clinical evidence of vitamin D micronutrient in female infertility. Vitamin D has direct effect on AMH production, that is anti-Müllerian hormone production. Thus, it increases the longer maintenance of ovarian reserve in patients with its higher concentration. Higher the vitamin D in body, higher the AMH concentration, and higher the fertility. That's what I want to say here. Vitamin D is an emerging factor which influences female fertility and IVF outcome. High prevalence of vitamin D deficiency in infertile women referred for assisted reproduction. So when we see the infertile women walking into our IVF centers, in my practice, do not check vitamin D of each and every couple, because it adds to their investigation, adds to their cost, because as such, we have a lot of investigations to do, which we cannot salvage. But here, if we do vitamin D, it adds to the cost. So I consider around 90 to 95% of them are vitamin D deficient, and in that cause, I give them vitamin D supplement itself. So it's a blanket rule in my practice to give vitamin D to the couple right from the beginning when I induce them to treatment of infertility. Low levels of 25-hydroxy vitamin D were significantly associated with autoimmune thyroid disease in women with PCOS. Coming to the next element, hyperhomocysteinemia. I can say that homocysteine is a bit ignored nutrient or the factor, and we consider more of vitamin D, vitamin B12, etc. In infertility. But it is known that unlike vitamin D or myo-inositol or our B12, where we talk about deficiency, this is opposite. In the sense, we don't want homocysteine to be more. We want vitamin D to be more or myo-inositol to be more. We supplement the body with these kind of things, but that is not the case in homocysteine. In homocysteine, it is exactly the opposite. In the sense, we don't want hyperhomocysteinemia to happen. Hyperhomocysteinemia, that is an elevated low level of homocysteine, is bad for the body. The risk factor for pregnancy are what happens when there is hyperhomocysteinemia is it reduces conception. It causes, even if the woman gets pregnant, it causes placental abruption. There is a higher incidence of recurrent pregnancy loss. As cardiologists, they say that hyperhomocysteinemia is known for many of the cases of myocardial ischemia, that is coronary artery disease. The patient dies because of heart attack when the homocysteine level is elevated. Similarly, we are also not happy when the homocysteine level in the body is increased. Now, in this slide, don't get confused. What I want to say is, this shows in a slide the metabolism of homocysteine related to B6, B12 and folic acid. This is one related to another, but it is in the reverse relation. What I want to say is the homocysteine, which I have put it in the center of the slide, because of B6, the homocysteine gets converted to cystathionine and cysteine. That is, the presence of vitamin B6 reduces the homocysteine level in the blood. That is, it converts the homocysteine to cysteine. Similarly, the homocysteine, because of the presence of vitamin B12, that is vitamin B12 converts the homocysteine to methionine, and then later on as adenosylmethionine, etc. The folate also gets converted to tetrahydrofolate because of methionine synthase, and all these things ultimately reduce the homocysteine level in the blood. The folate, vitamin B12 and vitamin B6. The presence of these three vitamins reduces the homocysteine level in the blood, and that is what we want. What does the folic acid do? A positive correlation exists between the insulin resistance and homocysteine levels. That is, if homocysteine level is increased in the blood, the insulin level also increases. We don't want both the things to happen because both are adverse to our body. Folic acid, B6 and others are involved in regulating the hyperhomocysteinemia. This is what I showed in my previous slide. An indirect relationship is observed between hyperhomocysteine levels and folic acid. More the folic acid, lesser the homocysteine level reduces once the folic acid level is increased. That's why we supplement the folic acid. Hence, the level of folic acid should always be kept high with the help of supplements. I was telling in my previous slides, that is when she comes for infertility treatment or after the urine test is or the beta HCG is positive, we add the folic acid. This is one more reason, not only the NTD. B group vitamins and folic acid administration counteract the hyperhomocysteine level and its adverse effects. Study of PCOS patients in which they were given 2 grams of myo-inositol plus folic acid for 12 weeks, that is pregnancy of 3 months, a significant improvement in the hormonal parameters and restoration of the PCOS patients. In those patients up to 12 weeks, there is a restoration of the menstrual cycle was observed. There was no need for adding estrogen, progesterone or any menstruation regulating hormones. Mere adding of myo-inositol plus folic acid for 3 full months has regulated and restored the menstrual cycles spontaneously. Folic acid is important for oocyte quality, oocyte maturation, implantation, placentation and further things, physiological things, whatever happen in the body. Subfertile women who took multivitamin containing 400 microgram of folic acid for 3 months, 26% had a pregnancy, that is around 25% to 20, that is 1/4, had compared to 10% of women in the placebo group. So this is around more than 2 times more spontaneous conception. Evidence suggests that higher consumption of folate pre-pregnancy may lower the risk of some infertility outcomes. Preconception folic acid use was also associated with many infertility treatments. You go to any doctor, the patient is put on folic acid because it has got many, many uses. And even in chronic diseases like bowel inflammation or chronic immunological diseases, many times we have to add connective tissue disorders, we add folic acid. Combined administration of MI and L-methylfolate is effective in PCOS women, especially for overweight or obese patients with a marked insulin resistance. 3 months of folic acid supplementation, daily 1 milligram, reduce the level of homocysteine because one does not tolerate other. If folic acid is increased, homocysteine reduces and vice versa. In hyperhomocysteinemic women with PCOS, 5 mg daily of folate for 8 weeks among women with PCOS also has shown beneficial effects on their metabolic profile, like their fasting serum insulin, their blood sugars, their HbA1c. It has shown on all the parameters. Vitamin B6, or also called as pyridoxine. This is another element. These are all the micronutrients which influence the female fertility. That's why I'm talking about all these. Vitamin B6 has been shown to improve the conception rate as well as the premenstrual symptoms. All of us use vitamin B6 for premenstrual symptoms. When the patient complains of breast tenderness, water logging in the body, and those kind of premenstrual symptoms, we do add vitamin B6, but it has shown that conception also has improved. The conception rate also has improved with use of vitamin B6. B6 has a harmonizing effect on two or more vital neurotransmitters like 5-hydroxytryptamine and dopamine. Maybe that is how, that is one of the role how it acts in premenstrual symptoms of the woman. In a randomized study, all women with B6 deficiency showcased a reduction in the hormonal and premenstrual symptoms, PMS symptoms, by the end of the study, especially where depression and anxiety were concerned. This is exactly what I was saying. Vitamin B6 improves the conception rate. This is according to the Cochrane database. Coming to our cyanocobalamin. Pernicious anemia is one of the causes of infertility. Pregnancy occurred after supplementation with vitamin B12, according to Journal of Reproductive Medicine. Insulin resistance, obesity, and elevated homocysteine levels were associated with vitamin B12 lower levels, vitamin B12 deficiency in PCOS women. So supplementation of vitamin B12 definitely takes care of insulin resistance and hyperhomocysteinemia. Insulin resistance was also associated with lower serum B12 levels concentration in infertile women. Cyanocobalamin causes prevention of neural tube defects also. Pernicious anemia is one of the causes of infertility according to Biomedical and Biotechnological Journal. L-arginine is another one. It improves the fertilization rate. It improves the circulation in the reproductive system. The blood supply to the ovary is improved. The blood supply to the endometrium is improved. It enhances the oocyte development and implantation of the embryo. L-arginine, what does it do? Impaired L-arginine metabolism contributes to low plasma nitric oxide. Nitric oxide is the vasodilator. We need more nitric oxide, thus the endometrium gets more blood supply. So the low plasma nitric oxide in PCOS women is known to happen when there is arginine deficiency. L-arginine improves the endometrial blood flow. This is what I was telling. L-arginine plays a key role in pregnancy and fetal development because the endometrial blood flow is improved, the placental blood flow is improved, the fetal nourishment is better, there is a reduced chance of PIH in these women. So ultimately, it is very good for the growth of the fetus. Nitric oxide improves the ovulation also, and it improves the pregnancy rates in anovulatory women with PCOS treated with clomiphene citrate. In clomiphene citrate, endometrium also is at jeopardy because the blood supply to the endometrium also is reduced because of its anti-estrogenic effect. That's why sometimes we have to add estrogen or sildenafil to improve the blood supply. So if the L-arginine is supplemented in these women, it takes care of ovulation also, it takes care of the endometrial growth also. L-arginine was found to improve the uterine and follicular Doppler flow. Thus, it may improve the ovarian response, endometrial receptivity, and thus ultimately the pregnancy rate. Oral L-arginine supplementation in poor responder patients may improve the ovarian response, endometrial receptivity, and pregnancy rate. Already told, in females, zinc plays a role in sexual development, ovulation, and menstrual cycle. This is in addition to L-arginine. Zinc also helps. L-arginine and antioxidant supplementation improve the circulation reproductive system. Arginine enhances the oocyte development and implantation of the embryo. This slide shows how the L-arginine acts. What it does is ultimately the endometrial and the immune dysfunction in the PCOS is taken care of by L-arginine. It prevents all the different problems that are happening, and ultimately it improves the ovarian circulation and the endometrial circulation because of the modulatory action on the endothelium of the blood vessels. Role of chromium. Chromium improves the insulin sensitivity at the insulin receptor level, which helps with the insulin resistance and the obesity seen in PCOS women. This is one more element. Infertile women with PCOS who were candidate for IVF benefited from chromium supplementation, other than all these things what we mentioned so far, for 8 weeks in terms of lowering CRP and improving the gene expression. Ultimately, the internal milieu was very conducive and friendly for the fertility side. Chromium significantly increased the rate of developing regular menstruation by almost twofold after 5 months. So 5 months of treatment given with chromium supplementation improved getting automatically the menstruation. Supplementation with chromium to adolescents with PCOS is a promising treatment option. Oligomenorrhea is the problem in these adolescent PCOS women. Effect of chromium supplementation on insulin resistance and ovarian and menstrual cyclicity in women with polycystic ovary syndrome was quoted in Fertility Sterility Journal, and they also told the same thing. 8 weeks of chromium supplementation among PCOS women had favorable effects on markers of insulin metabolism. I have already highlighted what are the markers of insulin metabolism. Nicotinamide, one more. Dyslipidemia involvement in the development of polycystic ovarian syndrome is directly related to nicotinamide. Nicotinic acid can improve the lipid profile by lowering the LDL levels and increase the HDL. HDL is the friendly lipid and LDL is not so friendly lipid. So HDL level is increased in the serum of PCOS patients. Niacin, also nicotinamide, will improve the postprandial hyperlipidemia and cardiovascular risk indices via its lipid lowering. It improves, in the sense it reduces its lipid lowering effects in patients with polycystic ovary syndrome. Pharmacological elevation of nicotinic acid may be an effective and non-invasive strategy for restoring and maintaining the female fertility during aging and for improving the success of IVF. The quality of eggs become better because of nicotinamide. Now coming to the oxidative stress, I touched upon this oxidative stress and PCOS. Increased ROS, that is reactive oxidative species, takes place due to hyperglycemia in PCOS cases. Because of hyperglycemia, the ROS level increases, which is a very harmful substance for all the cells. I can say that it is a poison for the cells. Oxidative stress contributes to it induces the insulin resistance and hyperandrogenism in PCOS women. Increased oxidative stress causes not only the PCOS problems or the fertility problem, it is not good for anybody. It increases the incidence of coronary artery diseases, dyslipidemia, obesity and whatnot. So this is what happens when there is oxidative stress. How does it affect infertility? Because the ROS is increased, the oxidative stress is increased. So that is a cascade effect, in the sense the maturation of the follicle is not so well done, the poor quality yield of the oocytes. So thus the embryo growth is also not fine, development is not fine, multiplication of the cells of the embryo is not fine, the granulosa cells are also not so good, the luteinization does not happen. When there are no lutein cells, progesterone production also is reduced. When we do not have enough progesterone, we have to supplement from outside, and that results in LPD, and that is also very harmful and detrimental for the fertility to happen. So we get caught up in the vicious cycle of this ROS. There is insulin resistance, androgen excess, obesity. We have to break this cycle, and that is a big challenge for the IVF specialists. So how do we break this cycle? The nutrients which reduce the oxidative stress in PCOS. Oxidative stress Somebody is operating my slides. I'm sorry. Oxidative stress contributes to PCOS, and the decrease of the antioxidants lead to decrease in the antioxidant level, mind you. That leads to the increase of oxidation products, and that contributes to PCOS. It is very detrimental to the body. Antioxidants such as vitamin C and vitamin E achieve an adequate antioxidant defense system, and they reduce the harmful effects of this ROS. They bring the oxidative stress under control to a certain extent. What? The supplementation of vitamin C and vitamin E. Antioxidants and vitamins have positive effect on the management of PCOS women. They increase the fertility because they control this oxidative stress and the ROS. co-treatment with coenzyme Q10 and vitamin E for 8 weeks in patients with PCOS provided improvement in sex hormone binding globulin concentration. Beta carotene, vitamin A, C, and E all constitute antioxidant defense system that eliminates ROS. It's been shown that vitamin E acts as an antioxidant which regulates the steroidogenic enzyme functions dependent on cytochrome P450. This is another vital thing. It's been demonstrated that decreased level of beta carotene may lead to the inactivation of P450. We want a good P450 action. We need the steroidogenesis of P450 in the luteal cells. Antioxidant supplementation may be effective in controlling the production of ROS and continues to be explored as a potential strategy to overcome the reproductive disorders associated with infertility. Up to 50 to 60% of recurrent pregnancy loss, to a very great extent, are attributable to oxidative stress. Observational studies have confirmed a link between antioxidant poor diet, the diet which we take, which is less in good antioxidants. In the sense, if we are not consuming enough fresh fruits, fresh vegetables, the antioxidant is very less in our diet. So antioxidant poor diet and the recurrent pregnancy loss. So good diet, the enough antioxidants is one of the treatment for these women of RPL. Female dietary antioxidant intake reduces time to pregnancy among couples when they have come to the clinic asking for pregnancy. Supplement them with antioxidants that will reduce the time to pregnancy. Selenium. Accumulation of the free radicals was detected in PCOS women due to the insufficient selenium level also, which leads to increased androgen levels including LH and total testosterone level. There is a hyperandrogenic milieu in the body because of selenium deficiency. So the supplementation of selenium prevents the recurrent early miscarriage. It also prevents the hypothyroidism during pregnancy. Zinc is required for eggs to reach maturity and be ready for fertilization. In females, zinc plays a role in sexual development also, other than ovulation and controlling of the menstrual cycles. Inadequate zinc levels could not stimulate the insulin receptors in patients with PCOS. Zinc levels can play an important role in the development of insulin resistance in PCOS level. Insulin resistance reduces to a very great extent once the zinc is supplemented. Significantly lower concentration of serum magnesium. I could not get any more studies other than only this one statement. Significantly lower concentration of serum magnesium was found in PCOS patients. Magnesium. Zinc, I have already told, plays a role in restoring fertility in women. Magnesium is required for eggs to reach maturity and be ready for fertilization. Selenium reduces miscarriages. So coming to the summary, the higher vitamin D levels are associated with an increased likelihood of successful pregnancy. A toxic level of vitamin D is very rare. We have to supplement all the patients with vitamin D because the lifestyle is such that we are hardly exposed to this natural sunlight. The quantum of the exercise what we have been doing has reduced to a very great extent, especially in the times of corona. The patients who were going for their regular physical exercise, they used to go to gym, they used to go for walk outside, they find the excuse that because of corona, because of lockdown, we are not able to go outside. So the quantity of exercise what they have been doing, the hours of exercise they have been spending on exercise has reduced to a very great extent. So ultimately, when we are not exposed to sunlight plus we are not exercising, the amount of vitamin D in our body definitely reduces. So no need to test all these women. You can directly supplement them on vitamin D. So that is associated with an increased likelihood of successful pregnancy and may be of particular benefit to women with PCOS. It's good for all, especially women with PCOS, because it reduces the hyperandrogenic milieu. Myo-inositol, as I have already told, told, this is just summary of it, helps the ovarian function and decreases hyperandrogenism and insulin levels. It plays a pivotal role in the physiology of reproduction and has beneficial effect not only for the women who are asking for pregnancy, even adolescent girls when their menstruation is not doing fine because of hyperandrogenemia, supplementation of myo-inositol brings their cycles back to almost normal. Folate, vitamin B6, B12, D, iron, etc. all have important roles in fertility. The importance of nutrition at a molecular level is well established as numerous processes, DNA synthesis are dependent. Exactly. This is very, very important. They are dependent on minerals such as the ones which I have already quoted. Studies have shown that higher intake of iron, folic acid, vitamin D, etc. are very beneficial for fertility and also the vitamin E. When there is an imbalance of reactive oxidative species, there may be, that is, increased quantity or increased levels of ROS, there may be an increase in the sperm DNA structural damage. When we do the sperm DFI, that is fragmentation, DNA fragmentation index of the sperm, it may be more than 30%, and that is detrimental, and that is the cause of male infertility. So, as well as an unclear link to female infertility, commonly studied supplemental and dietary antioxidants are D, E, vitamin C, beta carotene, coenzyme, myo-inositol, etc. Supplementation with micronutrients may be a good strategy to adopt in healthy women. Even if we are not doing anything for these women, let us just add micronutrients to their diet. Explain them about the importance of a quality food. Explain about their lifestyle and weight reduction. This is the minimum that we can do and take them towards the journey of having a baby. So maybe a good strategy to adopt in healthy women trying to conceive and in those with fertility problems all the more. Thank you all. Thanks for patient listening. Thank you, Mr. Madhusudan and Maya Pharma, for giving me opportunity to talk here. I hope I have given some information and was of some use to all of you. Thank you once again. Hello? 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 Hello?
Yeah, madam. Thank you very much, madam.
Am I audible?
Yes, madam.
Okay. I finished my talk, Mr. Madhusudan.
Madam, thank you so much for giving us a brief update on the role of female infertility. The audience are also very much happy. And they are.
I hope so.
Explained it. Madam, there are a few questions from audience. Can we move on to it?
Yeah.
If you wish. Okay. So first question, which nutrients we should give more before conception and which should be given more after conception? That's the first question.
I would give to all my patients, as I have told, is vitamin D and folic acid. Very much necessary for all of them. Folic acid and vitamin D. Rest of the micronutrients, of course, the tablets, whatever you people quote, contains all the micronutrients, because we can't go in search of zinc, selenium and chromium.
Okay. So, and the second question is, if we provide nutrients to patient during infertility treatment, we need to continue or stop once she get conceived?
No, I do continue them. I continue the treatment they have to take, because it is not only for the infertility treatment. We need a quality placenta also. As I have mentioned, the zinc, the chromium, all improve the nitric oxide. So the placental vascularity also is improved. Many of these, like magnesium, zinc, all have shown, calcium, that the deficiency of them results in pregnancy complications like PIH or placental abruption. So these are the problems which are big nightmares. We don't want to have all these problems. So till they are across 30, 34 weeks, I do continue the micronutrients in those women whom we have started the supplementation pre-pregnancy.
Okay. So, and third question, will PCOS lead to pregnancy complications? If yes, how we can prevent it through nutrients?
Yeah, as I have already told, the nutrient supplementation is very much necessary, but that is not all. Nutrient supplement is to treat the problems which I have already quoted in my slides, but we have to treat the proper PCOS. Other than the nutrients, the counseling is necessary so that she reduces her weight. Very important. When one's weight is reduced, around 10% of weight reduced, the fertility rate will improve by 10%. So, and the micronutrients will also act in a much better way because her obesity has come down. Her hyperandrogenic state, hyperinsulinemic state, hyperglycemic state, all this comes down once the weight is reduced. Then she needs the proper treatment also, like myoinositol, metformin, and then target her for the proper infertility treatment, like ovulation inducing drugs, and then take her further.
Okay. And does omega 3 helps in reducing oxidative stress?
Hello, Praveen. Yeah, that is yes. Omega 3 fatty acids, as I know, is very good. But I have no experience of omega 3 fatty acids pre-pregnancy. Like my infertility patients, I have not put them on omega 3. As far as my knowledge goes, it is helpful for the fetal growth and the placental development. It is very important. Like say the IUGR babies, where we want the weight to improve, or the oligohydramnios, where we want the fluid quantity to improve. So these are the patients, women, I put them on omega 3 fatty acids. But I'm sorry to say that I don't have much knowledge about the role of omega 3 in infertility patients. I don't put them on omega 3 when I treat them for infertility.
One more question: what dose of vitamin D3 you recommend in fertility?
Yeah, I do give 60,000 units, either as sachet or as a capsule or in the bottle, that is the small bottles what they come. I give them first of all I treat both of them, husband and wife, because as I have told that it is energizer of the egg as well as the sperm. I tell both of them when they come for counseling itself, I start them. I don't check the vitamin D. 60,000 international units. Every week I give them for 10 weeks, that is around 2.5 months. After that, I give them once a month for next 10 months.
And one more question, is it better to prescribe folic acid or L-methylfolate?
It is definitely better to prescribe the L-methylfolate. It's a better version of folic acid.
Thank you. And which nutrients are useful in male infertility? One more question.
All the ones which I have mentioned, but since my talk today was only on female infertility I didn't touch upon the male infertility, but all those which I, and one or two slides also told about the DNA fragmentation index of the sperm, etc., especially the vitamin E, vitamin C, vitamin D and folic acid. Other than the smaller ones like selenium, micronutrients like selenium and chromium and zinc, etc., vitamin D, vitamin C and E definitely important, and they reduce the DNA fragmentation index to a very great extent. Otherwise also there is no particular treatment. When we find the DFI more than 25%, we put them on antioxidants only.
So that's all the questions, madam. So okay. we have reached the end of the today's session. I'm sure today's discussion is very useful and informative to all the doctors attending the webinar. So once again, I would like to say thank you to our esteemed speaker, Dr. Eka Rajendra. And it was indeed my honor to moderate this session. Thank you to all our listeners for attending the scientific programs. Also, thank you, Mera Metabiotics, for sponsoring this webinar. Thank you so much.
Thank you all the participants. Thank you, Mr. Madhusudan. Thank you, Maya, for giving me this opportunity. Thank you. Wish you all a happy weekend. Thank you so much.
Have a nice day.
Bye. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.